presentation was ready. So it is Sunday morning, 9 a.m. And just to kind of, if you were regretting a bit that you're sitting here instead of lying in your nice hotel bed, I'm going to make it a tiny, tiny bit worse. Meet Abby. Abby is the first hit on YouTube when you Google crying baby. And you're wondering why I did that. Well, meet Abby's mom. It's not me, by the way. I was trying to get a picture of her face, but that really didn't work out because basically she was just calling that baby all the time. But Abby's mom has been listening to this crying baby, just in case you didn't remember how it sounded. She has been listening to this crying baby for a very, very long period of time. And I can imagine at this point of time, you want it to stop. Partly because you want to hear me speak, but partly because listening to a crying baby is horrible. The problem is that... So the benefit is here, I can stop this crying baby by pressing a button, one of them. But in the real world, that's not possible. And another problem is that scammers know that people have this instinct to not want to listen to crying babies. It's upsetting, and we want to help them. We want to help this mom who's been listening to this crying baby probably for weeks or months in a row now. And this is actually being used. These YouTube videos I just sort of showed you or had you listen to are being used by scammers as a weapon. Crying babies can be weaponized. And how that works, I just want to show you.
So I invited a few of the world's best hackers to try to hack me and show me where my vulnerabilities are. And now I'm going to meet them in Las Vegas for DEF CON, the biggest hacker convention of the year. They're going to hack me using social engineering, which is essentially hacking without any code. They just use a phone and an internet connection.
Do you want to do a sample phishing call?
What's phishing?
Phishing is voice solicitation. And basically what you do is you use the phone to extract information or data points that can be used in a later attack.
Let's do it. Who are you going to call?
Maybe I'll call your cell phone provider and see if I can get them to give me your email address.
I bet they're good. I bet they have my back. But yeah, go for it.
I'm going to spoof from your number, so it's going to look like it's calling from you.
Okay.
There it is.
Hi, I'm so sorry. Can you hear me okay? I'm sorry. My husband's like, we're about to apply for a loan, and we just had a baby, and he's like, get this done by today, so I'm so sorry, I can't call you back. I'm trying to log into our account for uses information, and I can't remember what email address we used to log the account. The baby's crying, and can you help me? Awesome.
In just 30 seconds,
at gmail.com,
Jessica gets access to my personal email address.
Now, if I needed to add our older daughter on our account so she could call in and make changes, how would I need to go about doing that? You would have to send me a secure PIN through a text message? Yeah, well, the thing is, I don't think I'll be able to receive a text message if I'm on the phone. Oh, I'm not on there either? So I thought when we got married, he added me to the account.
Jess uses my girlfriend's name and a fake social security number
5127
to set up her own personal access to my account.
Wait, I'm sorry, so there's no password on my account right now? Can I set that up?
She even gets the support person to change my password.
Thank you so much for your help today.
So she just basically blocked me out of my own account.
I'll get her fed after this. All right, thank you.
Holy shit. So they just gave you access to my entire cell phone account.
You're gonna have to...
So that's a problem. So cyber attacks basically usually consist of sort of the technical parts and the social engineering, the more human parts. And as you can see, social engineering can be very effective. What I want to talk to you about today is how these con men, like this female hacker, how they operate in cyberspace and how it's possible that they are successfully committing these crimes. My name is Sophie van der Zee, as you kindly introduced me. I'm an assistant professor at the Erasmus University in Rotterdam. And just to give you a bit of an idea of why I am doing this research, it's because I have quite an interdisciplinary past. I have a bachelor and a PhD in psychology. Forensic psychology, actually. I have a master's degree in both psychology and law. I spent a few years working as a postdoc researcher in computer science in the security department of Cambridge University. And I currently work as a behavioral economist, as an assistant professor. And the combination of these different fields basically makes up the basics of cybercrime. I'm specialized in deception and dishonest behavior, so people trying to defraud you or trying to lie to you or cheating on tests, and how can we find out that they're doing that? And I like to use technology. That's where sort of the computer science part comes in. So part of my research was on motion-based lie detection. So can we create a more accurate view of how people move when they're lying, and does that differ between truths and lies? So this is sort of nonverbal based. I've also done some research and this is the research that got us a lot of media attention, leading to newspaper articles around the world, two different documentaries, including a BBC Horizon documentary, where we actually tested these motion capture sensors in the wild. So people went to work, went to their family, talked to other people about their lives, and we filmed them and measured their behavior using these sensors, and then tried to figure out when they were lying and telling the truth. So can we detect deception in the real world? I also do language-based lie detection, which is much more relevant to the online scams, because online you usually don't have video images of someone or maybe video calling, but you do often have written text. So we've been using the written text of President Trump to see whether or not we can predict when he sends a tweet whether it's factually correct or incorrect. So we've been looking at analyzing his language use in his factually correct and factually incorrect messages. And it turns out, when you use verbal lie detection tools, that actually there's a lot of verbal differences between his sort of factually correct and his factually incorrect messages. We looked at those differences, and then we created a model. Then we collected more data and tested our model out of sample. And what we found is that we could actually correctly detect for new incoming tweets whether they were factually correct or not, so what he was talking about, based only on the words he uses, so not about content, so it's not what he talks about, but the types of words that he's using when he talks about them, 3 out of 4 times. So this could be used, for example, as a screening tool for fact checkers, that they don't have to fact check everything, but they fact check basically the sample that we provide. I'm also the founder and chair of Decepticon, and I just present the logo here because I was hoping you guys would appreciate it. A lot of people in psychology don't get it, but it's a wolf in sheep's clothes transformer style because of Decepticon. But Decepticon actually stands for Deception Conference. It is the biannual conference for people who are interested in deception and dishonest behavior. 2015 was with me in Cambridge, 2017 was in Stanford, and we're now organizing the next edition for next year. So if anyone has an interest in fraud, deception, dishonest behavior, definitely keep an eye out for this. Okay, so why this person with psychology, computer science, law, behavior, economics background, why does that person interested in deception look at sort of online fraud? Well, because fraud is basically deception. There's no con man who just comes out and says, I'm going to tell you a few things that are not true, but I'm going to do it in order to get your money. That's not what they do. Basically, they're telling you a story, or they're pretending to be someone else to con you into giving you money. Sorry that this title doesn't look better. But basically, if we look at hacking, which is sort of the basis of cyber criminals as well, or the main activity they do, hacking was sort of born at MIT. Hacking, in the beginning, didn't have anything to do with computers. Hacking was pranks. And one of their favorite pranks is, can they put any object at the dome of the MIT building? So at some point they managed to get the the police car, but then from the campus, like the campus police car on top of that dome. And the problem with pranks is that every year they have to get bigger and better. So a few years ago, they managed to get a fire truck, which is much heavier, much bigger, on top of this same dome. I think this was in 2006, and I'm a bit terrified of what is going to happen in the next couple of years. But when we talk about hacking now, so before the 50s, 60s, or let's say before the 50s, hacking was kind of pranking. Then the whole computer element came into place. But in the 50s, 60s, 70s, I would say it still had a very positive connotation, and it was very much about pranking. And then now, in the 80s, up till I think quite recently, actually, hacking got quite a negative connotation as well, in the popular media at least. And that had to do with cyber criminals actually using hacking for bad rather than for pranking and for good. So the definition of hacking that is usually used is that it's sort of an innovative use of technology, an eagerness to explore systems, and you use programming skills to do that. Okay. So within the whole community, there's this sort of desire, maybe not even the community, maybe in wider society, there's this desire to distinguish between good and bad hackers, because good hackers are very useful. They can work in tech companies and can help to explore vulnerabilities, for example. And then you have the bad hackers who actually cause harm. And the problem is, so this is called white and black hacking. And the problem is that actually a lot of it is quite gray. Because when you are a white hat hacker and you're trying to do this for good, one of the problems is that there are lines that, it's quite a gray area, and there's certain ethical lines that people tend to cross at some point. So one of the example groups is Anonymous, who were very angry after some of the attacks, the terrorist attacks that happened, and they started on a sort of vigilante base, they started to hack back and do a lot of things that in the wider society were considered to be actually not such a great idea. Okay, so for this talk, I'm not going to talk about sort of the white hat hackers or the people, the ethical hackers, the people that mean well. I am basically only going to focus on the cyber criminal aspect of hacking, the digital con man. Okay, so to understand cybercrime a bit better, it is important to realize how cyber criminals are organized. And one of the key features of cyber criminal networks is online forums and online marketplaces as well. They usually take part in the dark web rather than the general web. And these online forums, they use for communication. So they talk to each other about a lot of different topics. They also use it as sort of a Facebook, like they use it for social purposes. They like it to use it to chat to each other, to get to know each other. They also use it to actually discuss scam tactics. They use it to share their knowledge. They even sometimes use it to train people or to recruit people they want to work with. They can use it as a marketplace, although there's also separate marketplaces for that, to kind of buy and sell, for example, off-the-shelf malware that they can use for attacks. So a lot of cyber criminals who want to engage in cybercrime don't actually know how to do these technical things themselves. And I'll get to that in a moment. It's also a very important place for collaborating and networking, and as I mentioned, for recruiting people. What is interesting, because this maybe you already knew, but what is interesting is that these forums, there's a lot of police, for example, in the Netherlands, we have the National High-Tech Crime Unit. They're quite interested in following these forums. They know where they are, they know roughly, based on their IDs, who they are, at least digitally who they are. But they're not always intervening, because there's also a bit of an indication that these online forums can do good, in the sense that they're turns out to be a negative correlation between the amount that is being talked on these online forums about a certain attack and how many victims the attack makes. And I have to say it's correlation, not causation, but basically what it means is that if about a certain attack people talk more about it, actually it turns out to make less victims. So normally you would think the more victims, the more people talk about it, the more important it becomes. But here actually it turns out there's a negative correlation between these two. So the more people talk about it, the less victims it makes. They don't know what the correlation versus causation is, so they don't know what's causing what. But it is one of the reasons why the police tends to monitor rather than intervene in many of these online marketplaces. Okay. So when you think about cyber criminal networks, so this is research done by a colleague of mine who I work a lot with, Rutger Leukveld. He did his PhD thesis on cyber criminal networks. He's a criminologist and he's interested in how organized crime basically is organized. And what we know from the more traditional face-to-face crime, or the offline crime, what we know is that there's sort of tight organizations and in organized crime where people know each other. And then they sometimes recruit people that they need for other services. And they were wondering, how does this work for criminal networks? Are these a lot of sort of technical guys together who can hack, or does it work differently? And basically what they found is that they analyzed cyber criminal networks in a lot of European countries. And what they found is that there's basically four types of networks. You have number one, does this work? No. Okay, so number one is a completely social-based network. So there's people that know each other from the real world, basically. So there's social ties. Then number four is it's a network completely existing of digital ties. So people don't know each other face-to-face, but they met through these online forums. And then there's sort of two hybrid types. The hybrid two is one where the majority of people are know each other socially, and then a small part of the people they sort of recruited on these online forums. And the third one, the majority of people were recruited on online forums, and a small part is based on online ties. So just a question for the audience. Which of these four options do you think is most common in cyber criminal networks? Do you think it's mostly social, is it mostly social ties, so people in the offline world who know each other, friends, family, or is it mostly people from the digital world, from who know each other through forums? Who thinks social? Hands. Okay, I say three hands. Oh, four or five, sorry. And who thinks it's mostly sort of digital ties? Many, many more. I hate to say this to you, but you're wrong. The last group, the big group. Actually, the most common forms are the number two and three, mostly two, actually, that cyber criminal networks tend to be criminal networks that know each other personally, and then they recruit people into their network to do the things that they want to do. It also means that the cyber criminal networks are not just digital. They're mostly already doing other types of offline crimes, and then they're kind of starting to do the digital crimes on top of that. So how does a cyber criminal network look like? What you see is that they exist of the core members, and they really usually know each other through social ties. And then they recruit two types of people. You have the professional enablers, and that is the group that is usually recruited online on these social forums, and those are the people that have skills that they need. So for example, technical skills, they can build malware, they can send out phishing to large groups of people, maybe they have access to large databases with email addresses. Then you have the recruited enablers, and those are also through social ties. Because the recruited enablers, those are usually the people that you need. So for example, someone working in a bank or someone that you can get access to. And that's very similar to the non-digital organized crime. And then the last one that they need is money mules. And this can be both social or through online recruiting. So money mules, one of the newest, so basically money mules, what they do is they transfer the money. So these cyber criminals, they need to turn their money into get it into the legal system, basically the normal system. And what they do is they use people's bank accounts and transfer large sums of money to try and make sure that people can't actually follow their trail, the police can't follow their trail. So money mules used to be young, usually guys, and that has changed massively. So one of the things that has been happening is that the banks actually got on to these money mules and they started doing this fraud detection, and they realized when there's a young person suddenly getting a lot of money into their account, that might be a scam or might be fraud or there might be a money mule. So they're now better actually looking at those large sums of money, and they also look at whose bank account is it. Is it possible that this person got this money through legal means, or is it probably mostly illegal means? And the scammers realized we need to do something. So first the scammers used these young people, then the banks got onto them, and they now flag those transactions often up. And then what they did is they thought, okay, we need to find money mules who are not suspicious if they move large amounts of money. And who can move large amounts of money? Rich people. And who are rich people? Usually they're old, in the sense that older people, middle-aged people, tend to have more money going around in their account than young people. So one of these BBC News articles actually showed some, referred to some data showing that of the money mule cases that they get in the fraud center, that actually there's a massive rise in sort of elderly or middle-aged people. More traditional ways that have been used in online money laundering is Western Union and MoneyGram. Whenever anyone asks you to do anything through them, it's probably a scam. So just don't do that. There's also a whole line in online gaming that they're using online gaming to make payments and then actually get that back. And micro laundering, for example, through PayPal accounts has been very popular as well. Okay, so types of cybercrime and their characteristics. This is how we used to travel. This is how we used to sort of behave in public spaces. And this is what we do now. It's not necessarily, there's a lot happening in society where people talk about people never talk to each other anymore, but to be fair, we didn't used to do that much either. But what has changed is that where in the past you would get the newspaper maybe once or twice a day, and then you would read it, and you would spend the day reading, and then the next day you would get new news. Now we constantly check our phones and our laptops for what's happening in the world. So we kind of getting this constant stream of information. And we're doing a lot of different activities on those phones. So whilst you're in the train, and you might be on a public network, you may be making money transfers, you may be buying things online, you may be checking the news. And all those activities can actually pose danger. And what's interesting, and I think hasn't received enough attention, is that these different attacks that are around differ in their level of sophistication. And not by accident, this is on purpose. So what you can see is if you would divide the different attacks into these three categories, so one is no interaction, it will occur whatever you do, basically. One is a single message, and one is a dialogue. Actually, the level of sophistication and their method of attack is very different depending on these three categories, and I'll tell you why. So this is Nu.nl. This is one of the most famous and mostly used news websites in the Netherlands. And one of the problems with there are several problems with Nu.nl, including spelling errors. But one of the other issues is that it was one of the big websites in the Netherlands over the past few years that had drive-by downloads. So they had advertisements with malware in them. And if you would go to this genuine, very frequently used news website in the Netherlands on the wrong day, on the day that there was this malware advertisement, you could get malware on your computer without you doing anything dodgy. You didn't have to click anything, you didn't have to actively engage, you just go to nu.nl and you would have malware on your computer if you didn't have an ad blocker. And that's problematic. And in how many people are from the Netherlands here? Do we have any? Okay, so all the other people. So basically, in a very short period of time when this became popular, what you saw is that people, we had Nu.nl, so a news source. We had the Dutch eBay, Marktplaats. And we had Buienradar, which is basically the mostly commonly used weather forecast. All these three websites, in a matter of, I think, months, had these drive-by downloads, which basically meant that if you would have a completely Dutch population, and if I would ask them how often, who of you has, if everyone starts by raising their hand, and I would ask how often, who of you have visited a news website, nu.nl, then put your hand down, who has visited buienradar.nl, so the news forecast, the weather forecast, and who has visited the Dutch eBay, basically no one would be left with their hands up. So anyone in the audience, basically what I'm trying to say, can be the type of person who would have had malware on their computer based on drive-by downloads. So we're all vulnerable. Because what this means is drive-by download is you go to your favorite news website and you think you're safe and in a great, great environment. And then it turns out, without you knowing, you are actually in this terrible neighborhood. So in the real world, when you'd be walking here, you A, would try to not walk there, and B, you would probably hold on to your wallet or your purse. But the problem with these drive-by downloads is that you think you're here, but you're actually here. And there's not that much you can do about it. I'll skip these for now. Okay. So that was the drive-by downloads. If we go to the single messages, so what you need to think about is there are scammers and they're sending you an email or a text message. It doesn't have to be email, it can also be a text message. And that message contains either a web link that they want you to click on, or it can contain a download, and if you download the file, you will download malware. And if you click on the link, you will either get malware, or for example, it sends you to a fake website that looks like your bank website, but it actually isn't. I think everyone in this room knows what phishing is. Phishing basically is one of these email messages where you get a link or a an attachment to download. But then we also have spear phishing. And spear phishing means that they know something about their audience. So phishing just means you're throwing out this massive net and you're trying to get as many as possible. And spear phishing means you know something about people and you're using that against them. So for example, if they know from which bank I am or which bank I'm at, they can send me a message specifically from that bank. If I receive a message from a different bank, it's not that relevant to me, and the chances are higher that I think it's a scam. So for example, if you would be a member of ABN AMRO, which is a Dutch bank, then this could be a phishing email specifically aimed at you. And then there's whaling. Whaling is getting the big fish. And scammers are interested, yeah, these are the biggest fish there are, the number one and two on the list. this is on everyone's scammer's radar. And basically whaling means, or CEO fraud we also call it, is that you're trying to get access to information or accounts or the network or computers of people that have a lot of access and money. And because the benefits are much higher, the possible benefits, they're willing to spend a lot more time and attention to it. So for these people, or any people basically in a position of money and power, chances are that scammers are specifically looking for information about you personally. So who are you? Who are the people you know? Who do you work with? Where did you grow up? What was the name of your pet? Any information they can find online, or maybe even in your physical trash cans, dumpster diving that's called, to get information they can use in their attack against you. So the next one I want to discuss is a dialogue. So we first had drive-by downloads. You don't have to do anything. You do your normal thing online. But at that moment, there was malware on your normal website. Then you have this single message. So the single message means they send out a lot of messages, but only once. And with that message, you need to engage, interact, click on something, or do something. And then the scam is successful. With a dialogue, which is often advanced fee fraud, what they want you to do is they want you to engage, and there are multiple messages needed for this scam to be successful. So the most famous one, I actually added this because we talked last night about please don't add any Nigerian princes, and then I thought I just am going to do this anyhow. So one of the most famous examples is the 419 scams. 419 stands for the criminal code, criminal conduct code in Nigeria, where a lot of these scams originate. And basically what it means is you will get an email, for example, from a Nigerian prince saying, I have a lot of money, but I don't know how to access it. Can I use your bank account? And it's basically an idea of money mulling and then also transferring a bit of money to them so you would receive a larger amount later. The thing with this 419 scam that a lot of people don't realize is it's not new. It's actually from the 1800s, where the Spanish prisoner fraud is a very famous old example of an advance fee fraud, where they were doing the same thing, but then using letters. Or they were talking to people face-to-face, and they were saying, there's this person, this very wealthy person, and he falsely or wrongly got imprisoned in Spain. And we need you to help us with getting him out. And if you give a bit of money, then he will pay you back with a lot of money, basically. So it's the same idea as the Nigerian prince, but then centuries ago. Okay, so the communication patterns, why is this interesting? Because they communicate badly on purpose. Some of you may have received these Nigerian prince messages thinking, who will ever fall for this? And they mean to do that. So the problem is in these, because the Nigerian prince emails are a dialogue, and this idea of a dialogue is that the victims are going to email you back and you need to email them back as a scammer, and again and again and again. So that's taking time. So you basically want to maximize the way you spend your time. And how do people do that? If you send an email that is not believable, there will only be a very small percentage of people that will respond, and in general, that will respond. What you want to do is you want to maximize the green, basically. So if an email is not believable, most people will just delete it and not engage with you. There's a group of people who will respond, and of that group of people, some people will pay. That's great for them, because that means they can keep sending out emails, and the people that respond are likely to pay. The problem is, if you make it more believable, then the more people believe it, but aren't going to pay, those are the time wasters. So if you write a great phishing email that almost everyone believes, but the problem is it's not a one-click phishing email, it's an advanced fee fraud email where you have to communicate with them. A lot of those people, that's the red here, the time wasters, a lot of the people that respond to you will never pay you money. So the more believable your email message is, the more time wasters you will get of people who think, initially, this is interesting, but then when you need to pay up, they're a bit like, ooh, this sounds fishy, don't want to do this. So in these dialogue scams, you don't want to make it too believable, because then you get a lot of time wasters. And then we have the deliberate time wasters. So I don't know if any of you engage in this behavior, but we have the scam baiting, which is sort of time-wasting scammers as a sport. And it began, so if you are interested in this, it's quite funny to look at the website, 419eater.com. It's sort of a database of a lot of different scam baiting activities. And it started off with trying to engage the scammer back. So basically what they were doing is we're trying to make sure that the scammer is spending a lot of time on communicating with us, because then they can do less harm to other people. So they would try to get the scammer to do activities as well. So for example, take a picture of yourself eating a fish or doing something like this. And then they started to, because this of course became a bit of a thing, so it started to escalate a bit. So they started to give them, you need to put up a sign and take a picture, and the messages got bigger, up to really large, how do you call them, banners? Yeah. And they got a bit dirtier as well, and the dirtier, the funnier, of course, on this website. And then there were animals involved. This was a whole thing as well. So there were banners, there were animals, and then there was ethics, basically. So they realized it was getting a bit out of hand, and they created some ethical guidelines on how should you do scam baiting, and what should and shouldn't we do. Okay, so if they're sending these emails, how does this work? So imagine that message A is a message of a Nigerian prince. They send it out and see how many people respond, and of the people that respond, how many people will actually pay them. And then they're going to tweak it. So they're going to, if they feel this is a message too many people respond to that are not going to pay, they're going to change some details, try again, send it to another database. And then they'll do that process again. And then at some point, when they're sitting in their internet cafe, they see at the screen of their neighbor, they talk to their neighbor, and he says, well, we shouldn't use the Nigerian prince. Do you know what I've been doing? I've been doing romance fraud. So I'm trying to fraud lonely women into dating me. And that seems to work, and the same process happens. Or another type of fraud, and another type of fraud. And this is basically how these different types of scamming and fraud evolves. This is one I got this week, actually. This is my head of department, this is my boss, and I got an email. This was spear phishing as a dialogue, because the message itself didn't contain a link or an attachment. So this was someone pretending to be my boss, Jan van Oers is his name, and ASA.ur, that's our group, economic or faculty, economic school, Erasmus School of Economics at Erasmus University, Rotterdam. But they created a Gmail account for him. But this was a dialogue because there was nothing I could do now. But this is someone, he's only our head of department, and this is someone who really tried to start a dialogue spearfishing account this week to me. So social engineering is something that is being used not for the no interaction, but for the single message and the dialogue ones. And I will continue. Sorry, I was a bit excited. My husband's here, he knows that I do this, and he warned me for this, and then I still didn't. sorry. So just to, do I have two, five? Sorry, perfect, I can do this in five. So, social persuasion techniques. We know them from buying a secondhand car. Basically, it means it's a sort of marketing strategies. How do you sell something to people? And how do you sell something to people is not just interesting for people trying to sell things, but also for scammers. So there's been some people in the field, in the academic field, interested in finding out how effective are these scammers and what type of social persuasion techniques are people using. So the most famous sort of list is by Robert Cialdini, and there are six different social persuasion techniques. Liking, so the more people like you, basically, the more likely they are to say yes. It also involves if you're more similar to someone, so you're more alike someone, they're more likely to say yes. Reciprocity, so if I do something nice to you, you want to do something nice back. Social proof, if you don't know, especially in ambiguous situations, if you don't know what to do, you look around and see what other people do, and you're more likely to do that too. Commitment and consistency, if you say, I am planning on quitting smoking, then technically you should be more likely to actually follow through because you made a commitment. In practice with smoking, actually, that turns out to be quite hard. And appeal to authority, that's why the dentist's commercials always have people in white lab coats, basically. So you refer to authority to show that your claim is legitimate. And then we have scarcity. So this is what happens a lot in sale, like op is op in Dutch, or whenever you're running out of time, or there's other people competing for this too. So anything to create a sense of urgency. So then there's been a follow-up sort of social persuasion research in the context of scamming. So Frank Stegiano, who was one of my colleagues in Cambridge, he did a really interesting study where they actually categorized a lot of different types of fraud and scams. And what they realized is when you apply these social persuasion techniques to scams, there's two more social persuasion techniques that are commonly used. One is dishonesty, so deception basically, so you're lying to them. And one is distraction, so they're trying to make you talk about something else and then actually they're doing something behind your back. And I've been applying this to rental scams. So rental scams are fake advertisements for accommodation. So people may be interested in letting some apartment. They're moving somewhere. They're looking for a place to live. And then you look online, what can I find? So in Cambridge, the problem is it's very expensive. It's a bit like London. And people start looking instead of just on the regular websites, on websites like Craigslist. And then suddenly they find, cheaper than what they've seen before, this lovely apartment. The problem is this lovely apartment is more likely to either look like this or actually not exist at all, or at least not in Cambridge. It's probably a very luxury holiday rental somewhere in Paris. So this is one I found this morning at 6 a.m., I think. It's still happening. I was just looking at Craigslist in the UK. It's still happening. The advertisements are still there. So what did we do? We looked at Craigslist and we scraped these different advertisements for apartments. And we did that for a three-week period in 27 UK cities. Those were the ones that are on the Craigslist list. And in total, we scraped more than 2,000 advertisements, and then I manually categorized them as either genuine, fake, or I have no clue. There was also quite some irrelevant ones, or dodgy ones that I just ignored. For example, offering, if you give me sex or let me take pictures of you, you can live here for free. That was outside the scope of our research. So we collaborated with Yahoo, and we got 1,000 unique email addresses from them. And they were random combinations of a first name and a last name in the UK. The first names were gender neutral, so the scammer wouldn't know if it was a boy or a girl. And I responded to all of these fake or don't know advertisements with a scripted email. And they were all different. I used a lot of different words. But something like, I'm interested in your apartment. Is it still there? It looks great. Please let me know more, basically. And then when they responded back to me, I started writing real emails. Following this set of guidelines, if they asked, I was female, I had job security of 1, 2, or 3 years in an academic job. I couldn't go for a viewing easily because I was moving there from a different city, and I didn't smoke and I didn't have pets, just to make sure they wouldn't reject me for other reasons. And in each email, I would show an interest in their property, and I would ask for a viewing, and I would wait until they responded to me saying, I want money, basically. So when they requested money, I would stop. And then after they requested money, I will send another 3 emails. This is what we found. We coded all these interactions for the different social persuasion techniques, and we found that liking happened in more than 90% of the emails, a claim to authority more than 80%, commitment and consistency more than 80%, scarcity more than 70%, and social proof almost nothing. What was interesting is that although in the other study by Stagiano, they found distraction and dishonesty, we didn't find it in this type of scams. What we did find was 2 new ones, which is establish credibility and remove obstacles. Basically, if they offered, you can either get it furnished or unfurnished. You can, of course, you can park your car or motorcycle in the middle of London for free. and a lot of those types of things, whatever question I would have, they'd be like, of course that's possible, no problem. Then usually that was a scam, because normal landlords are not that accommodating. The last thing I want to mention, and then I'm done, is just one of the example emails that I got from them. This is a person, a scammer, saying, thanks for getting back to me. I wouldn't want you to get me wrong. The idea of making a confirmation of your financial ability is not only my idea, but my solicitor and I decided to use that process, and I can't violate my solicitor's procedure. A, there's a lot of spelling mistakes, and B, a solicitor is not usually involved in renting things, and C, this is an appeal to authority. Then we get, I'm a God-fearing woman and I'm not after your money. Sometimes they even warned me for other scammers, saying this is a dangerous place, watch out. I have my own work, so they're trying to establish, like, I'm not a threat to you, and I earn enough money for my family and also to help the less privileged. Wow, that's creating liking. So there's a lot of appeals, social persuasion techniques here. The problem is, they're not in line with our culture. The God-fearing woman, I'm sorry, but in the UK, that's not a thing. Like, people are not impressed by that. And a solicitor is not usually involved. So what we see is that they're trying to mimic genuine landlords, but they kind of fail because of cultural misunderstandings. And this is where I would like to leave it. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this wonderful talk, Sophie. So we have about 7 minutes for questions. Who wants to go first?
Thanks very much. The obvious question that occurs to me is, a lot of those things I understand are just need to be careful, but is there any way to protect against these drive-by downloads?
No. That's not completely true. Having an ad blocker helps, because most drive-by downloads occur in advertisements. The problem, advertisements for a lot of genuine websites as well, is their way of income. So there's several genuine websites that say if you use an ad blocker, you actually can't use this website. So it's not always possible to use an ad blocker on all websites, but it definitely, thank you, but that definitely helps against drive-by downloads. So an ad blocker, and be a bit careful, and keep an eye out on the news, because usually almost all the big drive-by scandals did pop up as a news article quite quickly after people discovered it. So that's another way to protect yourself a bit. What I do want to make clear, because you're saying, like, is there anything you can do against the single message scams? There's quite a lot you can do. There's things you can check. So always, for example, you can hover over where the web link goes to. You can hover over the actual sender. So don't just look at the title of the sender, but actually what email address was used. That doesn't always help, because with spoofing, you can actually pretend to send emails from someone else's email address or send messages from someone else's phone address. So I've received scam emails from my mom to me with her actual email address. And I've received WhatsApp messages from the phone number of one of the girls in my football team asking for money, and she was actually traveling, saying, "I'm traveling, lost my card, please send some money here so I can actually get around." And several people from my football team actually did that. It's not just about sort of being stupid, which is something you hear a lot, that you're being gullible or you're not actually paying attention, but a lot of scams actually either are so sophisticated or you don't have to do anything, that you don't have to be gullible to become a victim of cybercrime. Yeah. Oh, sorry. And then you. Yeah. Sorry.
At the beginning of your presentation, there was the story about fishing in Las Vegas with Jessica. My question is, do you think something like that would happen so easily in Europe now that we have this general regulation about on data protection? I suppose that's the English name of it. Do you think so?
So the GDPR is the European law on data protection, and I just don't think it's still possible. I know it's possible. So easily, yeah. So I one of the research projects I'm doing is looking into phishing and phishing, voice phishing, and to see sort of which characteristics of phishing and vishing actually makes it most effective. This research is not completed yet, otherwise I would have included it in my talk. But the people I work with spend regularly days, so they're working at a security company and they're hired by the company, and then they're going to call people from this company to see what information they can get, and it's scarily easy. In one morning, they can get from several employees passwords, get into their accounts, personal information. Yeah. So, yeah, sorry. It really is that easy. You don't even need a crying baby. I think you were. Just one more thing. So people think this won't happen to them, but it will. Like, it will. I've been scammed as well from a spoofed email message and my Cambridge University account, where something, I can't remember what it was, but something bad had just happened in the world, and there were a lot of charity things happening at that point, and I got an email, my email account, from a Cambridge University student email address saying, "Hey, we're trying to collect money for this, what happened, do you want to give some?" And I was like, "Sure, fine." And that turned out to be a scam. Yeah.
I want you to talk to you about the time wasters.
Yeah.
Because you reminded me of this. I'm sure you know it. There's this thing by this British comedian who he actually tries to engage with this scammer. If anyone has not seen it, it's on YouTube and it's pretty hilarious.
Yeah.
But it also reminded me of this automated bot that was created called Rescam.
Mm-hmm.
I've just checked it now because I completely forgot about it until I saw your talk. And do you know the people behind this thing? So apparently it's this bot where if you throw an email that you've got from a scam, then it will engage with the scammers to try to waste their time. And apparently they've gone into phase two, and I have no idea what that is. So do you know more about this bot?
I don't know what's currently happening. I know it exists. I don't know the people who made it personally. But basically what the vigilantes were trying to do is to optimize their time. So instead of personally engaging and sending all those emails that was costing a lot of time for these vigilantes as well, or their scam baiters, they decided, can we actually optimize this and write some code to do it automatically? So now they're trying to waste as much of the scammer's time as possible without spending too much time themselves. Because this is typically what you see, is this is the type of thing that people are interested in doing for a bit, or when it gets more and more extreme, as you were seeing in my slides as well. But then at some point, you basically, like, it becomes quite repetitive. So by optimizing it, by writing some code to do it, they try to fix that problem. Okay, perfect. Well, thank you. There's one very exciting person at the back. Let's talk afterwards during the lunch break. Is that okay? Thank you.
Thank you very much.